Porkins Policy Radio, offering a unique perspective on everything. Geopolitics, culture creation, the reality of the world we live in. Coming to you live from New York City, your host, Pierce Redmond.
Well, hello, everybody, and welcome to the inaugural episode of Porkins Policy Radio. As my friend Chuck Ocelli said in that lovely intro, I am Pierce Redmond. I am the host of Porkins Policy Radio. You can find all of my work at PorkinsPolicyReview.com. And quickly, before I get started, I just want to thank everybody over at AFR. A big thank you to Danny Romero, of course, for getting me this radio show. A big thanks to Ed Opperman, who first introduced AFR to my work. And, of course, a big thanks to Chuck Ocelli, who was instrumental in helping to get the show and in supporting my work. So thank you, everybody, over at AFR. I hope you enjoy me and my podcast. But without further ado, I am joined today by my very good friend and frequent collaborator, Tom Secker of SpyCulture.com. So, Tom, how are you?
Yeah, I'm good. I'm good. It's very hot here, but as it is there in New York, you were saying.
Yeah, I've got the windows closed, the fans are off, and the sun is beating down through the window. So it is unusually hot. I did an interview recently. And I actually halfway through had to I took my shirt and my shorts off for the interview. So hopefully we won't get to that that point today. But anyway, Tom, thank you for being the first guest on the show. And just for all the listeners out there who may be unfamiliar with your work, explain a little bit. Who is Tom Secker? What kind of podcasting and research do you do? And what's on your website?
Well, I mean, first, congrats on the radio show. I know we've been talking for a while about how you'd like to get into radio, and then Ed and Chuck and everyone, they kind of made this opportunity happen for you. So, yeah, I just want to echo what you said and thank them for making this happen, helping to make this happen. And, yeah, well done, man. I'm glad this is going on. Who is Tom Secker? Good question. We'll move on to the website. Right. SpyCulture.com is essentially a repository of information about the government's relationship with the entertainment industry. I do a podcast called Clandestine. We do a podcast together called The CIA in Hollywood. I post documents. I review books that relate to this. I, you know, review films and other things that are part of this whole world, this whole milieu. And yeah, it's essentially a study, if you like, and, an attempt to open source this whole topic, because I file a lot of freedom of information requests to get the actual documents on this, because it's one thing to kind of speculate about this or to try and dig around on IMDb. You can get somewhere doing that kind of thing, and we've got somewhere doing that kind of thing.
For sure.
You can make some connections, you can find some interesting stuff out, but it's like, where do you go from there? So where I went from there was starting trying to get lists of from different agencies, different government agencies, both in America and over here in the UK, of films and TV shows that they'd been involved in. And then from there, I went after the regular activities reports of the entertainment liaison offices. These are the actual offices out in Hollywood who are liaising and dealing with the entertainment industry. So we've got a bunch of those now. And I'm still going at it. I'm still trying to find new ways into this, new ways to get more information out of them. And, yeah, it's an ongoing process, as you know.
Yeah.
It's time-consuming, but, you know, sometimes you get stuff that you just like, wow, I'm amazed we can actually get this on paper. We actually have the evidence that this is what's actually going on. So, yeah, I think it's worth it.
Oh, yeah, for sure. And again, while a lot of this stuff is out there publicly in things like IMDb, or as we've discovered in doing the CIA in Hollywood show, a lot of this is in audio commentaries, bonus features on DVDs, interviews with people. A lot of this stuff is also it does take a little bit of effort with a FOIA request, and FOIA can come up with all sorts of bizarre little tactics. I know at one point they wouldn't release you. the CIA wouldn't release you a FOIA request, right? Because you weren't a citizen. And I ended up having to like send them a little check or something like that. So there's always weird little things that they'll pull, but a lot of that information does trickle down, and you have found quite a bit of that, Tom. So my hat's off to you again. But speaking of culture creation and the CIA and Hollywood and all these sort of things, we thought for this first episode that we could maybe talk about a character that Tom and I have explored in quite a bit of detail in the past. And he's one of these characters that if you want to understand particularly what's going on between the CIA and Hollywood, you have to know this guy. And his name is Chase Brandon. And Chase Brandon was the CIA's first official entertainment liaison officer, who moved out to Hollywood in the mid-1990s, like 1996. And he set up shop there and got very involved in assisting and in sometimes literally crafting and writing certain Hollywood films. So, you know, Tom and I have talked it before on numerous podcasts, but he was involved in all sorts of Meet the Parents. It's now come to light that he basically wrote the script for The Recruit, which is a very influential CIA-assisted film. He was involved in Charlie Wilson's War, right, Tom?
Yeah. The Good Shepherd,
Good Shepherd,
Bad Company,
yeah.
Some of All Fears, a whole bunch of different stuff, really. I mean, this is the thing. Chase Brandon was a career CIA man. He joined sometime in the early 70s. He was there 35 years. That's a long time to spend in any organization. And for the last 10 years or so of that, he's the entertainment liaison officer. They're first. The CIA did make some efforts towards this in the early to mid-90s, but they kind of fumbled it. They didn't seem to really actually have any overall strategy, at least from what we can tell. So then they established this formal office late in 1996, and Chase Brandon starts calling up producers and screenwriters and going out and attending Hollywood parties and inveigling himself in every way he could find into the entertainment industry. And over the following 10 years, he was involved in maybe a dozen major movies, about the same number of like major TV series, a whole bunch of other little History Channel and other one-off documentary specials and things like that. And he also, the funniest thing about Chase Brandon is his appearance in these making-of documentaries on DVD extras and all of that, because you get a sense of just who this man is. He is a very slippery fish. This is a guy who can, you ask him a question, he'll give you like two sentences to actually answer the question in three different ways. He really, really has a very peculiar way of speaking, where he can imply something and completely deny it at the exact same time. And yeah, you can tell this is a man who is steeped in the culture of the CIA. And presumably this is why they gave him the job. They knew he was loyal. They knew he knew various different parts of the CIA. He wasn't just an operations officer, right? I mean, he did spend some of his time in the 70s and 80s running around Latin America, getting up to heaven only knows what.
Yeah.
You have to think he's seen some horrible stuff in his time and probably done some horrible stuff in his time. Or at least, you know, ordered someone else to do it.
And he certainly alludes to that in some of these making of features. I think it's in The Recruit he talks about the dark side and, you know, and having to kind of be careful when you step over that line. And but at the same time says, oh, we never really do that. I think you were pointing out to me recently, didn't he basically admit in, it was some, I think it was a making of feature that I think, wasn't it he himself had hired mercenaries at one point when he was working in the CIA?
No, I mean that is in a little making of special for Mission Impossible, the first Mission Impossible film, which is one of very, very few films to have been allowed to shoot at Langley. You may remember in the first Mission Impossible, they break into Langley to get into this super secure vault to, you know, that's the signature sequence in the whole of that film. But in the run up to that, you remember they sneak in via a fire truck? You'll remember when you watch the film again, there's an actual shot of a fire truck driving up the road towards Langley, and it pulls up and you actually see the CIA campus and it says, you know, CIA headquarters, Langley, Virginia. So you can only, you know, it's not like the CIA has stock footage of that. You know, they allowed them to go there with a helicopter and a film crew and actually film this happening. Not very many films get that opportunity. So you have to consider that first film in the Mission Impossible series, I suppose just, you know, part of an elite category in all of this, right?
Well, I'm thinking Argo got to film in Langley, and Ben Affleck was given full reign to wander around Langley with a camera, according to himself, you know, to his own accounts of it. I'm trying to think. I don't know of too many other movies that direct, like they were filming and like they had like a full on Hollywood film crew there.
Very few. The first one was Scorpio back in the 1970s when they first started making kind of pretty vague attempts to work with Hollywood in a formal way rather than, you know, completely covert way, as we've discussed. There's Argo, there's Patriot Games.
I'm really struggling
to think of any others at this point now. And according to Tom Cruise, he says on the commentary for the most recent Mission Impossible, Mission Impossible 5, that you can't do this anymore. That they actually approached Langley and they got turned down. They got told no one's allowed to film at Langley anymore, but cinema. They'll give you like stock footage, you know, aerial footage so you can do an establishing shot. And we've seen that in quite a few films, right? But they won't actually let you turn up there and film. And even The Recruit didn't actually film at Langley. The scene where you see, it sort of did, right? The scene where you see him drawing up in the car and going through the gate with CIA logo on, that's real. That was actually shot at the headquarters. But when he actually gets inside the building, that's a reconstructed set. They, you know, let them go there and take photographs, but then they reconstructed it internally and that's how they shot it. And that's like one of the most CIA influenced films of all time. So it is something they're quite protective of, I guess is what I'm saying here. It's you know, very, very small number. What was the question? Oh, Chase Brandon, right. In the making of on the special edition DVD for the first Mission Impossible, one of the people they interview is Chase Brandon. They also interview a whole bunch of people involved in the International Spy Museum, which I'm pretty sure is a CIA front. And Chase Brandon basically says, like, does the CIA sometimes hire companies to do the jobs that they can't do, that have to remain deniable? And he sort of shrugs his shoulders and goes, well, yeah. And you're like, hang on a second. Isn't that quite a big admission for someone to be making, that there are some missions that are so dirty the CIA won't do them themselves? They'll hire someone, obviously not exactly like in the films, but something along those lines, you know, a Kroll or a Blackwater or whoever, to do it for them. That's quite a big admission for someone who's supposed to be, I guess, promoting the CIA. Yeah. But this is the mystique of Chase Brandon, isn't it? That he sort of admits that the CIA is this horrible organization, but at the same time always managed to twist it round and make it sound cool or sexy or necessary. He's very clever.
Listening to him talk sometimes, I mean, he does have this ability to draw you in, and again, talk about horrific, you know, killing people and lying and cheating and stealing. That's what, you know, he's does a whole thing, and I think it's in The Recruit where he's talking about, you know, CIA work is really about lying and, you know, stealing from people that you pretend to be friends with. Which is like a pretty nasty quality, to look for in somebody in recruiting them. But again, going back to the, generally speaking, with Chase Brandon, his career has been enormous in Hollywood, working on tons of films, and some films he admits to working on, others he doesn't. He claimed that he was just an advisor on The Recruit. Then it turns out, according to Trisha Jenkins, who's an academic researcher that Tom and I know, in her, the latest edition of her book, The CIA in Hollywood, she was basically able to piece together through some documents and things like that, that he wrote the script. He ghost wrote the script. And the screenwriter of The Recruit just basically slapped his name onto it. So very interesting. But getting to Chase Brandon himself, he is this bizarre, mysterious character. Tom, talk a little bit about his website, because there have been some odd things in the past with his website and some even odder things going on right now. But talk a little bit about his website. I know that sounds bizarre, probably out there, you know, talking about his website. But we've found time and time again with some of these bizarre characters that are involved in Hollywood films, they have even more bizarre websites with hidden things on the website. There are certain, you know, links that you wouldn't normally see that you have to click on. There's other strange things. Talk a little bit about his website and the way that he lists certain films on his website, say, not on his IMDb.
Okay, well, on his IMDb, as I remember, he only has 4 films. And I think that's Sum of All Fears, Enemy of the State, The Recruit, and Bad Company.
Mm.
So that's, as far as, you know, if anyone was searching on that and they came up with him, those are the only 4 productions that they know he had any involvement in. And it just says technical advisor, which could mean anything from a small role to a massive role, couldn't it? So when he left the CIA in late 2006, maybe early 2007 when he actually retired, and it's several years later, like 2013, I think, when his website, chasebrandon.com, actually goes live, actually has some content on it. So for several years, if you searched for him, you'd basically come up with a handful of newspaper interviews, and that'd be basically it, you know? Mm. Very, very little information about him at all. Then he launches this website, which does evolve a bit over time, and he adds additional information that wasn't there the first go-round. On the homepage, it has this weird kind of drop-down menu thing where if you want to find out more about his credits as a writer and as a technical advisor, you have to click on the drop-down thing and then it kind of slides, but then you have to click on the next bit, so that slides out. And it's like, why would you design your website like that unless you were trying to make it hard for search engines to crawl it and make it hard for people to get this information? You also have a few other bits and pieces about, you know, his interest in some weird kind of sculpture and some article he did for Popular Mechanics.
Yeah,
whole bunch of irrelevant nonsense that it's like
aliens.
Why, yeah. Roswell, blah, blah. There are also a whole series, maybe 10 other pages on this site that aren't linked to from the homepage. Because you know how it is. You set up a website. You want people who arrive on your homepage to be able to access all parts of the website more or less from there. Or maybe they go into subcategories and they're all under there, right? That's how you organize it. Or you have a search function, you know?
Mm.
Brandon's website doesn't have any of that. It has like this very, very basic navigation, no search function, and all these other pages that you can find ultimately, or could, you should say, you can only find them by messing about in other ways, by like searching for all results under a particular URL. You know, you can do that on Google where you search for everything within the site, spyculture.com or porkinspolicyreview.com. I found them that way. So you look on those, you find out there's several other movies that you worked on, like Meet the Fockers, that aren't mentioned in the main section. Mm. You find a whole bunch of TV shows that he worked on that aren't mentioned in the main section. You find that he worked on a script with Hillary Henkin, the screenwriter of Wag the Dog. That isn't mentioned anywhere else on the site. And, as we hypothesize, could be quite significant, right?
Yeah, yeah.
We'll get into that in a minute. So this is, you know, Brandon's website is deliberately designed as a weird labyrinth, only to be negotiated by people who are really trying to dig and find this information. So I can only assume my IP address is now in some logs somewhere, because
yeah,
I'm
definitely
one of only maybe 100 people, you know, yours is too, and, you know, a handful of other people who visited from our sites or people we've shared the links with. Sorry, but I imagine all your IPs are on some vague list somewhere, because very, very few people will have seen this information. And then, a month or two ago, I'm not quite sure when, the website goes offline. And it seems this is just that the registration of the website, either the server or the, you know, domain registration or all of that, ran out. Because for a while there, that URL, chasebrandon.com, was actually available. And we were discussing, you know, Is there some mischief he had here? Yeah, should we buy it and do something with the site? And but then when I checked it like a week later, it's not there anymore. It's been re-registered. The domain is now the property of Chase Brandon once again. It's there on the Whois database. So,
who uses AOL, right? Wasn't it an AOL email?
It's an AOL email. I won't tell you what it is, but obviously people can look it up if they're interested, and it's kind of funny, but also sad at the same time. So, but there's nothing on the site anymore. All the pages are gone. All the information's gone. The URL is still there, and it's still hosted on some server somewhere, but there's no actual content. When you go to the site, you don't get anything. So what's all this about? He seems to be deliberately trying to create mystery and contradiction and questions and intrigue and suspicion and guesswork around what was he actually doing? What was his actual job? What did he, on a day-to-day basis, month-to-month basis, year-to-year basis, what did this man actually do in Hollywood? Because we know some of it. But so much of it, he's like said one thing and then contradicted it somewhere else, or you can only find it if you get to the special secret part of his website or whatever. I mean, yeah, as I said at the top, he's a very slippery fish.
I wonder if, since we've started looking into this and really doing some pretty serious research into the relationship between the CIA and Hollywood, and between, the government and Hollywood in general, because, of course, the Pentagon and FBI, all these, three-letter agencies are involved with them. But there also seems to have been this, like, marked shift where we had Argo and Zero Dark Thirty. And those were like the kind of pinnacle of the relationship between the overt relationship between Hollywood and the intelligence services. And, you know, this was, I mean, obviously people are probably familiar with Zero Dark Thirty and the, Catherine Bigelow and Mark Bull were given top secret, classified documents. They allegedly flew out to this secret staging ground, which I don't know where the real one is, but in the movie it's called, they're at Area 51, so I don't know what the hell to make of that. But and this is very, very overt. Again, Ben Affleck saying, talking about how everyone in Hollywood is a CIA agent, and then suddenly it kind of dropped off. We stopped. There was a pushback. There was suddenly you have things like Judicial Watch and even members of Congress wondering, well, why was Catherine Bigelow given classified information? Why was she allowed to see this? And in a recent episode where we do Zero Dark Thirty, we wonder if the whole movie wasn't just one bit, the whole purpose of the movie was just to convince people that Bin Laden had actually been assassinated, which is a pretty wild thing for a movie studio to get behind. But I wonder if this, like, disappearance of Chase Brandon isn't because of that, that because there's been so much exposure of this relationship to the point where I think now there are even average people that wouldn't have really cared one way or the other that are starting to wonder, well, is it okay that the majority now of popular entertainment is connected in one way or another to the CIA and even more so to the Pentagon? Tom, you've talked about these internal reports that we went through, all dealing with the Pentagon's relationship with, like, cupcake wars and real garbage television.
All sorts, particularly the food ones, like Face Off and Big Kitchens and and the CIA did one. What was it? The one that Leon Panetta went on, Top Chef.
Yeah, Top Chef, right, I forgot about that.
So this is clearly some weird thing going on with the CIA, and particularly the DOD, and especially the Marine Corps, is that they have this fascination with reality TV based around food. And I did float a hypothesis about this, which is basically this, that when you're watching a show about food, it's food porn, right? That's partly why you're watching it.
Yeah.
You want to see some really nice looking food. Who wouldn't, there is something very primally attractive about that. That's what it's serving up. Sorry.
That's all right.
So when you're watching it, that's your relationship with the show. And it also tends to make you a bit hungry. It's very difficult to watch more than an hour of reality TV about food without eating something, right? So if, while you're feeling that little bit of hunger, that little bit of insecurity about, you know, I need a meal, some, you know, something's got to happen here. If they're then hitting you with, oh, and isn't the military great for providing you with a stable and secure country where food is always available and blah, 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 blah. It actually strikes home with you. At that point when you're feeling just that little bit of vulnerability because you're hungry, if they're then serving up a, sorry, I'm going to stop doing this in a minute, a message of food security, and thanks to the Pentagon, and that's why we live in a great country and all of that, it's actually very effective. It's more effective to do that to people when they're, you know, a little bit scared, a little bit angry, a little bit anxious, a little bit hungry, a little bit tired, whatever. A little bit vulnerable in some sense, it's a whole lot easier to sell them the myth of security. So I can only assume that's the overarching reason for this, the overarching thinking behind this. But they don't make it clear in the reports. I'm, you know, I'm speculating here, yeah, really.
Well, so many weird questions with that alone. I mean, and I wonder, again, they're not, at least we haven't seen anything indicating that in the reports, but I mean, I wonder if they did some, you know, focus groups on that. Like, will you, you know, would something like, would Cupcake Wars or like Top Chef with some twinge of the Pentagon in it, is that more successful in indoctrinating people than just the, you know, straight up, you know, like the stupid like Navy commercials that we have here, or even like things like, you know, CNN and just like cable news? I wonder if there's like any connection between, again, these like food reality shows. And it's not just food. I mean, they love, like, Pentagon has been involved with Survivor and American Idol and a ton of different things. But I wonder
every Darwinian reality TV show you could think of, almost. Not yeah. every one, but, you know, a huge proportion of them.
Well, I figure that's just too. The Pentagon loves competition. You know, it's all about the U.S. being, you know, winning whatever that game is, you know, the New World Order or something. So of course any sort of silly ice road truckers or something, where, you know, they compete, well, is this truck gonna, you know, get across the ice faster than the other one? You know, they love that. It still kind of plays into their general way of viewing, you know, their worldview. And again, you know, everything is competitive. I mean, look at like sports. You can't, in this country, you can't watch a football game or a baseball game or anything without basically being one long commercial for the Pentagon, particularly.
Or even like even the other way around. I was watching a video today of an interview with an admiral who was the head of the Navy's entertainment liaison office. He's retired now. He was being interviewed about them doing like a classics basketball match on the deck of a Navy battleship. As a kind of promotional event. So it kind of works both ways, that you can both have the sporting event as the stage for some kind of military flyby or, you know, circus performance, whatever it is that they're using to say, yay, go military. But also the military themselves are kind of inviting these people in and saying, we can host this stuff. We can be the backdrop. We can be the staging area for your piece of theater. So it's a very, you know, circular, symbiotic relationship that only seems to be getting closer and more intertwined with time. That's the thing. If you compare the Entertainment Liaison Office reports from the last 5 years to the previous ones we have from like 10, 12 years ago, they're busier. They've got busier. They've got more involved. They've got more proactive. They've got more aggressive. This actually was, to me, the most, like, profound thing that was in all of these reports was that we found that the Pentagon in 2010, 2011, 2012 were reaching out to various people in Hollywood, like serious big people, big talent agencies, big studios,
William Morris and Endeavor.
Well, yeah, William Morris being the big talent agency that they went and met with, but also Sony, Warner, the big studios. And the purpose of this was not just to shape forthcoming productions, as they put it, So get involved in the scripting and pre-production phase, but also to talk about the general trends and the general, like the, what was anticipated was going to be popular in 2, 3, 5 years time. But they wanted to get in on those discussions. They wanted presumably to get intelligence from the movie industry about what they were planning so that we can only assume the purpose of this was so the Pentagon could go back and they could say, okay, if this is what Warner Brothers are aiming to do over the next 5 years, how do we tally ourselves with that in the best way? They don't just want to, they don't just sit around waiting for someone to turn up and say, can we borrow an aircraft carrier? And they say, yes, if you withdraw this racist joke from the script that makes our soldiers look racist. That's not all they're doing here. It's much more proactive and aggressive. It's like they're trying to take over this. They see Hollywood as just more territory to be conquered, almost. And that's worrying. That's really...
Yeah, that's a disturbing thought. I mean, I was thinking in some of those reports, they mentioned this meeting that a couple top Pentagon officials had with executives of William Morris Endeavor, which is the largest talent agency in Hollywood. They represent everybody, including, you know, Michael Moore, who loves to bitch and moan about the military all the time. Well, his bosses were meeting with top Pentagon officials, and the purpose of those meetings was for the Pentagon to figure out how they could get involved at a developmental level of film. So again, along what you were just saying, Tom, they're not necessarily, they don't want to have to wait until the script comes to them and, oh, well, you've got to take out this line, you've got to change this character a little bit, and then you can get the aircraft carrier and these F-16 fighter planes. You can get all that. Now they want to be involved at, like, before the script even comes out, you know, crafting the ideas. So that's a really powerful idea that I don't think people let, like, settle in that much when they talk about this topic. And we've seen that quite a bit. It's sort of like a – anytime it's brought up, it's sort of like a sometimes they just talk about it like, oh, well, isn't this useless, you know? Like, instead of, you know, trying to catch the terrorists or making movies about terrorists. Well, that's not really the issue. I think the issue really is that they're not only creating the terrorists, but they're also creating the movie about the terrorists. So they can really kind of control all angles of this. And again, something we've talked about is the power of Hollywood films in the way, and I think this is, like, again, beyond predictive programming. I think that, I mean, I don't know, you probably agree with me, Tom, that is lost almost all meaning for me.
It is somewhat overused now that people see any piece of popular culture or even, you know, fringe culture that somehow predicts a future event, regardless of how closely it predicts it or whether it's just a sort of like one line in the movie sort of predicts a news story 6 months later. People attach this tag to it, this notion to it. Whereas what we've tried to focus on is, well, where do the predictive pieces of popular culture intersect with the state? That's the important part. Because think about it. If you're writing a spy show and you're thinking, oh, well, what could terrorists do? We've got to come up with, you know, 12 different types of terrorist attack for our spies to deal with for this series. What are the different scenarios? And sooner or later, they're going to dream up something that some terrorist, whether state-sponsored or not, actually goes and tries to do, or does. You know, sooner or later, that's just going to happen. And if you have so many spy shows on TV, obviously the statistical likelihood of that is higher. So I don't see that as inherently suspicious. My interest has always been in, is the state doing this for some kind of nefarious reason? Have they weaponized that tendency of art to try and prophesize, to try and imagine what could happen? Mm-hmm. Have they tried to turn, you know, has the CIA and the Pentagon tried to turn, and by extension, MI6, Foreign Office, State Department, whoever, tried to turn that into yet another weapon of psychological warfare? And I think the answer is yes. And getting back to Chase Brandon, this ties in two ways. I think the Pentagon learnt that whole thing, the importance of being involved in pre-production, I think they learned that from the CIA, because that's how the CIA mostly deals with Hollywood.
Yeah.
If you read Trisha Jenkins' second book, she quotes, I can't remember which public affairs officer it was, the chief of public affairs while Brandon was there, or one of them. And he says, you know, in the office, Chase Brandon spent most of his time on the phone just pitching ideas and storylines and characters and plot devices and locations and whatever he came up with, or his masters came up with. He just was sitting there phoning up, you know, any screenwriter he could, any producer he could, any director he could. Who can I push this on? Who can I try and pump this into? That was actually what he spent most of his time doing, rather than actually working on productions. He was proactively just trying to seed useful ideas, ideas that the CIA would think were useful in popular culture for whatever reason.
Well, the whole before like drones and before the kind of general concept of targeted killings. So obviously now everybody knows what a target, you know, people out there, you know, on the average guy in the street knows what a targeted killing is. But before that became a meme or something that was within the ether of the public, Chase Brandon was pitching that to, what was the show?
The Agency.
The Agency, yeah.
Can we get into The Agency?
And Chase Brandon, and that's sort of like the, you know, like, anyone unfamiliar with our work, Tom and I love the show Homeland. or have a very, you know, love-hate relationship. With the show. But, you know, before Homeland, there was The Agency. I would say that that's in many ways the kind of precursor, and it's not nearly as good, or is interesting. But, I don't know. So I'm talking about The Agency. Talk about, the show and Chase's, connection with it.
Well, I mean, actually, I'd say Homeland is like a combination of those three shows, 24, Alias, and The Agency.
Yeah.
Because these are three shows, all of which debuted just after 9/11, all of which at some point in their production involved the CIA, and certainly with Alias and The Agency, that was from the very first seasons. With 24, it's not entirely sure how early on they got involved in that. But whatever. I think Homeland is kind of all three of those in one. Really, or tries to accomplish all of those things, and sometimes succeeds and sometimes fails miserably.
Yeah.
Anyway, The Agency is like a procedural. It's a bit like
Law and Order.
Yeah, something like that, as applied to the CIA, where you get to see them just, you know, going about their business, blah blah blah. And this is one that got the full works. They got to film scenes, I think, inside Langley. They had CIA people wandering around as background extras, which, if you think about it, the CIA is usually quite protective of the identities of its people.
But you'd think.
For obvious reasons, but yet they were happy in several of these. In the Company of Spies was another one, where you just had literally hundreds of CIA people just milling around, pretending to do work, pretending to be, you know, delivering files from one place to another or whatever they're doing. And they're all on TV. We can actually go and watch them if we care to. Anyway, the show actually premiered at Langley. The first episode was shown and was screened. You know, they had a special screening of it like a week before it was due to broadcast. But the interesting thing was that very first episode involved a massive attack on the West by Osama bin Laden, which is responded to with a war on terror. And bear in mind, this episode was due to broadcast like 3 days after 9/11. So it was written months and months earlier. And this episode had to be pulled from broadcast. They put out another one as the first episode in the series and moved that one down to, you know, six or seven. They moved it down the running order so they had less whatever. It wouldn't upset people. So this show was seen at Langley. Then 9/11 happens. Then it gets pulled from broadcast, at least for a couple of months. This isn't usual, you know? This doesn't just happen, right? This isn't just some sort of confluence of funny, strange events. This is more than that. And when you go into The Agency more specifically, you find several storylines that were predictive of real events. There's another episode a few weeks later that involves anthrax attacks. And this episode goes out literally the day that the anthrax story broke. As I remember, it's the actual day. So,
Yeah,
then in the second season, like a year or 18 months later, whatever, they have a storyline whereby a rogue Pakistani general, one of these, you know, rogue Pakistani generals that we hear so much about who are secretly Islamists, who would have thought after we spent so long encouraging this to happen? And he's, you know, gone rogue and he's causing trouble and he's threatening some kind of Islamist takeover of Pakistan and going to use the nukes and all the rest of it. So the CIA planned to take him out by firing a Hellfire missile from a Predator drone. And at this point, those drones had only really been used for surveillance purposes. They'd a couple of times tried to attach missiles to them when they were sort of trying to get bin Laden, but were, you know, not really trying to get bin Laden. In the
Missing him by just that much.
Yeah. He's gone again. He's run off on that camel again.
Yeah.
It's amazing that this, you know, the United States, which spends hundreds of billions a year on military equipment and personnel and training and all the rest of it, couldn't catch up with one guy running around Afghanistan. But anyway.
Well, it's hard to catch a 6-foot-tall Saudi with dialysis.
Yeah. Well, they move quickly on those camels. Sorry, I'm being a tad bit racist there. But anyway, you know, I don't think you actually... Yeah. Do you get camels in Afghanistan? Maybe you do, maybe you don't.
I don't think so. I think they use horses.
Yeah, well, okay, horses. So anyway, this storyline appears in an episode of The Agency. And within weeks of it broadcasting, the CIA actually used a, you know, Hellfire missile fired from a Predator drone, the exact same scenario, to take out some Pakistani military officer who they said had gone rogue and was involved with the Islamist enemy. So the exact same scenario occurs. And one of the other funny things about that episode is that it contains not just one, but two different instances of the whole notion of an exercise being used to mask a real operation, of an exercise that goes live. Because both the Pakistanis and the Indian military are accused in this episode. They're both sort of, you know, moving their troops around, and it looks like they're going to break out into all, you know, full-on war. And they're both using exercises as dummies to move their troops into different places with the idea that if this breaks out into a proper fight, we're there ready for them. So, yeah, it's not just seeding this war on terror narrative about drone strikes. It's also seeding that alternative media version of events where all of this is covert operations and, you know, exercises are always used to mask some nefarious activity.
Mm.
And when Trisha Jenkins interviewed the producer of The Agency, or the writer-producer, what's his name, Michael Frost Beckner, she asked him, was this predictive ability that the show had a result of your dialogues with Chase Brandon? And he basically said yes. He said, you know, most of these ideas, the drone strike, the anthrax, there was one other that I'm not remembering off the top of my head, and the whole 9/11 style launching the war on terror episode. He said, yeah, those ideas basically came from Chase Brandon. So what on earth was he doing? I mean, now we've established that this is going on, indisputably, you know, I mean, I don't know if you could get Michael Frost Beckner on the phone to confirm this, but I'm sure Trisha Jenkins isn't lying. I'm sure she, you know, when she interviewed him, he actually said these things. She's not in the habit of selling wolf tickets. So he said it. That's it. It's, you know, we know this is going on. The question we're left with is why? What were they trying to accomplish by this? Because again, this is disturbing stuff. And like I say, I think it's Brandon's involvement in doing things like this. That's probably what twigged the Pentagon. That's what made them twig. Oh, this is the best way to actually gain the kind of influence that we want, is to get involved in the earliest stages when we're not just reacting to a script and saying, oh, well, why don't you include this? We're going in at the story making stage saying, well, why don't you give it this kind of direction, or have a character like this be a major part of this? And this is what we're seeing more and more of.
Mm. And I think to, you know, again, just what you were talking about, well, I'm sure there are people out there, so, well, that sounds like predictive programming. But I think it's a little bit more than that. It's not, they're not, like, they're not secretly telling us what's going to happen. And I don't even think it's that they're necessarily preparing us for what's going to happen. I think a lot of these aspects are about there is an event, because a lot of times these happen afterwards, like with Zero Dark Thirty. You have an entire movie that essentially is telling you this is the official story. You don't even have to listen to CNN or you know the president or any of those other things. They're telling you this is the story, this is the narrative, and again they're able to do this because they get in at the very beginning. So I think again the predictive programming thing just to, and we can get off that it is it's not that important anymore because now
I think it's a simplification.
Yeah,
that's sort of one possible dimension of this. There are potentially a lot of different reasons why they might be doing something like this, and a lot of it could be experimental. It's you know seeing how people react rather than saying we want to accomplish this specific reaction, therefore we are going to propagandize people in this way. I'm sure a lot of this is, well, what happens if we write a female soldier in as the boss in this film?
Yeah.
How will people respond to this? And, you know, I think we know how quite a lot of people will respond to that.
How will people respond to a Pakistani general getting vaporized by a drone? Is that a bad thing? You know?
Yeah,
will people even care?
Yeah, will they even care? Will they turn around and say, hang on, but I thought at this point Pakistan are supposed to be our allies? Because at that point they were. It's only really, to be honest, it's the Obama administration who kind of dumped Pakistan and started a very, very increased drone program there that has also then resulted in a lot of chaos for Pakistan. Up until that point, up until about 2008, they were, you know, one of our regional enforcers, one of our buddies in the area.
Yep.
So it's... I think a lot of this is, you know, testing that out. Will people accept this as an enemy image? Will they, you know, if we 5 years down the line decide to ditch this country and suddenly reverse our diplomatic position with them, will people accept it? Rather than saying, we're planning to do this, therefore we're going to put it out there so that people think of it before it happens. But,
right.
I think it's a simplification. Yeah.
Well, I mean, that's like the, and I think also people only look at predictive programming nowadays in the big sensationalist sort of a way. So, you know, if tomorrow there was a Hollywood movie that came out about some Muslim guy who goes on a shooting spree, and then, you know, inevitably there's a mass shooting, whatever, 3 months from now, the predictive programming. Whereas with, say, a show like Homeland, I don't think it was really predictive programming where they basically wrote into the, an entire season that relationships with the U.S. and Pakistan would disintegrate, that the Pakistanis were working with al-Qaeda, and furthermore, that the Taliban would gain control over Pakistan all over the place, all over Afghanistan.
Well, not that just the Taliban. Remember, it was the Taliban and the Haqqani network.
Yes, exactly. Right.
The whole season, the central character, Haysam Haqqani, is based on the very real Jalaluddin Haqqani.
Yeah, who is now second in command to the Taliban.
Yeah, yeah. They now have a so-called power-sharing agreement in the region. And I was thinking, well, this all happened on Homeland 18 months ago.
Yeah.
And like you say, this isn't just about predicting something. This is, I think more profound.
Well, I think it's too fast, too. You know, I think it's too quick to be predictive programming. You know, like you would assume you'd need a little bit of time for this to settle in. It's like you've got Homeland, and then the next. I mean, with the most current season, you have an episode of Homeland where a CIA asset, Syrian CIA asset, is blown up in a plane by the Russians, and then literally 24 hours later, you have a Russian plane being blown up by ISIS. I mean, that's no longer predictive programming. I mean, that's something far different. That's really going beyond into manipulation of reality on a whole other level. That screw predictive programming.
That sensationalist version where it's all about the individual event is. It's quite often not about the specific events themselves. It's, I guess, more about encouraging
hyper-reality, too.
Yeah, yeah, encouraging that. Encouraging people to become ever more confused about, did this actually happen? Is that something I saw on Homeland, or is that something I saw on CNN? I can't remember anymore. Is it something I saw in a meme on Facebook? Did it, you know, is it real? Is it not? It's very difficult for people who are so swamped with information to answer those questions. And I think that plays right into the hands of psychological warfare artists. And so they're, if nothing else, one of their motives is just to encourage that, to keep that going, to make it even worse for people. Because the more confused people are, I guess the easier it is to pull something like that off. And hence why now you have this strange thing where potential covert operations, potential false flags, are quite often responded to by people asking that. Is it real? Did it really happen? And I'm thinking, is that the most productive question to be asking at this point? Is that ever the most productive question to really be asking compared to the, was this a massive crime perpetrated by the state? You know, you put those two questions side by side. Which one is more threatening to the CIA? It's the second one. Mm. So no wonder they would encourage people to ask the first one. You know what I'm saying here?
Yeah. No, and I mean, now it's on a level where, I mean, unfortunately, you have a whole generation of people, particularly a lot of them my age group, who just don't believe anything. You know, everything is false. We really are living in the Matrix. But leaving that aside, because I think, you know, there's a lot of people out, you know, in a basement smoking weed, constantly watching YouTube videos and literally watching the Matrix over and over again. But I think that the blurring between popular culture, like television shows like Homeland or movies, and real world events also just sort of serves the purpose of informing the public on whatever it is. So you could be actually quite well knowledgeable about world events and only watch the show Homeland. Particularly in the last two seseons, they were really going after the whole Russia thing, Russian infiltration, the Russians are everywhere, Snowden spying, Laura Poitras, the whole, you know, Snowden and WikiLeaks, all of these sort of things are combined in there. So I think it's also just another way of informing the public. Like, you know, now soon, I don't know, this is crazy, but, you know, maybe we'll come to the day where there is no news. It's just movies. You know, just like, you know, CNN just starts playing, you know, Zero Dark 30 and things like that over and over again, or very clever shows like Homeland. And that's how we are now informed on all events. So again, that goes beyond predictive programming. This really goes into the cleverest kind of propaganda, because people aren't even aware that they're being manipulated when they're watching these things. And again, to bring it all back, is that really what the entertainment industry is supposed to be about? I know they're pretty horrible, by and large. You know, there's a lot of problems in Hollywood and with popular culture. But I think I would take the sleazy, horrible side over the sleazy, horrible side with this involved. I don't know, Tom, we're coming up on the break soon, but any kind of a few things on just that whole relationship or the trajectory that we see that going in?
Well, I mean, one thing, I suppose there's all sorts of things we could say on that. With Homeland, one of the things that we hypothesized was that in the most recent season, season 5, you have this ever-shifting moral loyalty. You're never really sure who it is you're supposed to be rooting for. Obviously, you're not supposed to be rooting for the Muslim terrorists. But apart from that, you've got...
Tom, we've got the music coming up. Can you stick around for a little bit?
Sure, sure.
Okay. All right, we'll be back in a few minutes with Tom Secker, and we'll continue our discussion. We'll be right back.
like very much.
Radio. You're an American institution. American Freedom Radio.
Did you know there are 3 million edible food plants on Earth, and none have the nutritional value of the hemp plant? HempUSA.org offers you hemp protein powder. It does not contain chemicals or THC, is non-GMO, and is 100% gluten-free. Hemp protein powder burns fat, builds muscle, contains 53% protein, and feeds the body the nutrients it needs. Call 888-910-4367 and see what our powder, seeds, and oil can do for you. Only at HempUSA.org. HempUSA.org introduces 3 brand new detox formulations of micro plant powder. Brain Fuel for depression, bipolar disorders, and stress. Total Care, anti-cancer agent that cleans the liver and organs and increases memory. Rejuvenate, invigorates and heals the body, mind, and spirit. These products are your alternative to pharmaceuticals. Call 888-910-4367 and like us on Facebook. We ship worldwide. Only at HempUSA.org.
We all know that they're not telling us the truth. So stand up for your rights, demand the real medicine, and your right to use it and grow it. This is Rick Sensen, and you're listening to American Freedom Radio.
I'd like to talk a little bit about the war in the Persian Gulf. You know my favorite part of that war? It's the first war we ever had that was on every channel plus cable. We like war. We're a warlike people. We like war because we're good at it. You know why we're good at it? Because we get a lot of practice. This country's only 200 years old, and already we've had 10 major wars. We average a major war every 20 years in this country, so we're good at it. And it's a good thing we are. We're not very good at anything else anymore. Huh? Can't build a decent car. Got no steel industry left. Can't educate our young people. Can't get health care to our old people. Now, you probably noticed I don't feel about that war the way we were told we were supposed to feel about that war, the way we were ordered and instructed by the United States government to feel about that war. You see, I tell you, my mind doesn't work that way. I got this real moron thing I do. It's called thinking. And I'm not a very good American because I like to form my own opinions. I don't just roll over when I'm told to. Sad to say, most Americans just roll over on command. Not me. I have certain rules I live by. My first rule, I don't believe anything the government tells me. Nothing. Zero. Nope. And I don't take very seriously the media or the press in this country, who in the case of the Persian Gulf War were nothing more than unpaid employees of the Department of Defense, and who most of the time function as kind of an unofficial public relations agency for the United States government. So I don't listen to them. I don't get all choked up about yellow ribbons and American flags. I consider them to be symbols, and I leave symbols to the symbol-minded.
You're listening to AmericanFreedomRadio.com, the network who perseveres in delivering intelligent debate, constructive dialogue with true independence. The freedom to broadcast the truth is not free at all. So what is American Freedom Radio worth to you? The empowering information with fun, honest and pure integrity behind it provides an example to follow. Friendships to flourish with the moral altruism that pulls no punches. The hosts sacrifice and show remarkable discipline in their duty to deliver quality radio in service to the community with strength, wisdom, and loyalty. The founders of AFR wish to thank you personally for sharing your views and insights to make the best radio and alternative media. Now it's time for you to give something back and play a vital role in the future of America. Be as generous with us as we've been with you. Click on the donate banner at AmericanFreedomRadio.com or volunteer by emailing AmericanFreedomRadio@ymail.com. Vaccines, psychotropic drugs, and artillery batteries not included.
No rules. No rules. No taboo topics. No taboo topics. No fear of doom. No fear of doom. We are American Freedom Radio. American Freedom Radio. Porkins Policy Radio, offering a unique perspective on everything. Geopolitics, culture creation, the reality of the world we live in. Coming to you live. live from New York City, your host, Pierce Redman.
Oh, hey, everybody. We are back. My name again is Pierce Redman of Porkins Policy Radio, and we are joined by my good friend Tom Secker of SpyCulture.com. And Tom, you were talking there at the end again about Homeland and about the power that the CIA has in influencing not just predicting events, but really influencing our worldview on things. You want to kind of finish up what you were talking about there?
Sure, sure. I mean, I suppose basically the point is that, you know, more people watch Homeland than watch the news. Or more people watch, you know, Homeland or Person of Interest or The Americans or one of these other shows than watch the news, or at least a lot of the time. So a lot of their shape of the world is framed by this. But, I mean, my specific point was when we were discussing Season 5 of Homeland in an awful lot of detail, one of the conclusions we had was that because of the ever-shifting loyalties in the show, because at one point the hacker seems like the bad guy and then Carrie recruits him and he's part of the good guys again and blah, 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 that you're left in a position of thinking the world is just too horribly complex for me to deal with, that you don't just have this ontological confusion, this confusion about what reality is or what is real and what isn't real. You also have this total moral confusion where you're not sure where your loyalties are supposed to lie, what values you're supposed to have, what you're supposed to admire, and what you're supposed to be repelled by. And as a consequence, people exist in this... I mean, you were talking about people just not really even believing in anything anymore, and that's very much a characteristic of Western society in recent decades, but it's getting ever more so because of this kind of thing. And it does leave people in a position where they just... Not only do they not really even believe, they don't even particularly care. So then it becomes like, well... Who cares whether Snowden is this, that, or the other? Who cares whether our relationship with Pakistan is like this or like that? Who cares if we kill terrorists? I mean, it's just too complicated for me to make a moral decision on, so I'm just going to leave it up to the experts in the CIA and the White House. And so, again, rather than it being about specific events, a lot of it is about the worldview, but also how we see our role in that worldview, whether we're actually... supposed to be some kind of force of resistance against this, whether we're supposed to criticize it and oppose it in some way, whether we're supposed to go along with it, whether we're supposed to just not care at all. I think a lot of the time they'd rather we just didn't care. They don't really need our consent. But if we don't care, it doesn't matter whether we are opposed to it or not, because we're not going to do anything. So apathy is a very, very powerful tool.
Yeah, and I think that's probably... benefits the powers that be even more. I know that it's become very in vogue within the alternative media to talk about, you know, divide and conquer, and everything is a race war that's being fomented by George Soros or something. But I think apathy is perhaps even more important, and that is certainly. been I think looking at current events, you know, this never ending presidential election, apathy is way more important than whose side you're on, you know, because ultimately what's going, you know, you obviously there are these divisions. Oh, you know, Trump is a truther and Hillary Clinton is evil, and they're both evil. It really doesn't matter. And I think they're probably more happy for people to just simply not care than to actually start picking sides. And again, does the deep state really want us to be so factionalized that we're going to, you know, go to war with one another? No, of course not. They would much rather prefer we didn't really care about anything. And we just go back to watching Pentagon assisted Food Network shows. That's way better. Than actually, you know, thinking.
Engaging in politics at all, really.
Yeah, right. Yeah, and again, too, it's no longer a question of, well, what really did happen on with this particular terrorist event? It's more just, I don't even know. It's too confusing. It's too weird. And I'm just going to let the CIA kind of make up their minds for me. Again, that's, I think, a much more powerful... agenda or desire than actually pitting people against one another. And obviously they love pitting people again, you know, two people or two groups off one another. But yeah, again, I think the apathy is much more widespread. Go ahead, John.
Well, on the whole, divide and conquer, creating divides between people and getting them to fight each other. Obviously, that is a useful tactic in some ways, but I can't help but think, in terms of like the election, especially, is this not like what you do with a misbehaving child? Is you get them go and do something that tires them out, and then they, you know, stop harassing you and saying, why can't I have the latest Action Man figure or whatever that they're doing to annoy you? I'm just talking purely from a, you know, parental standpoint. That is actually what parents have to do quite often with their children, is because, let's face it, a lot of children have more energy than the parents do.
Yeah.
So it's tough. I get it, you know.
And the state is just one big parent.
Well, or at least they see it that way. They see us like that, as sort of stupid, unruly children who won't always do what we're supposed to. And so, you know, every once in a while, we're fed this great big soap opera where we take sides and get all angry and we argue with each other on the internet and then when we meet each other in coffee shops to buy our overpriced coffee and all of that stuff. And what's the ultimate effect of it? Not a huge amount of difference for the political class. It makes a bit of difference whether we get Trump or Clinton, but it doesn't make a huge amount as far as they're concerned. Everything is more or less still going to be the same for them. It might be a bit different for us. That's kind of all it really adds up to, as I see it.
Well, and that's all politics.
From their perspective, well, yeah, I guess. But, you know, from their perspective, keeping us busy, getting us all tired out and apathetic towards politics for a few more years, and then when we've had a bit of a rest and we've come back, oh, excited and angry and all over again. And so psychologically, it's very powerful the three quarters of the time. And elections and the occasional referendum and things like that act as, you know, periods of a steam valve exercise, say, or like with a kid where you get them to go and run around the field and play football all afternoon and then they'll probably actually eat their dinner and go to bed. You know, that's kind of how they see it. And I think it is actually incredibly effective. And that's, I don't mean that in a really pessimistic or depressing way. It's just to try and observe that's what's going on.
Yeah. No, and of course, entertainment is the best way to seed this to people. And again, you see, you know, having everyone obsessed with entertainment. You know, it's like even things like Netflix. You know, with this, it's just like binge watching. You know, that's all it's about now. It's not, you know, nobody even cares about if it's a good TV show or not. Well, even if it sucks, well, whatever, I can watch all 20 episodes on Netflix. You know, that's my whole Sunday right there. I'm not going to be concerned with, I don't know, what the Federal Reserve is doing or what's going on geopolitically in Central Asia and how this might affect whatever, you know, anything. None of that really matters. And I think that's a general kind of thing with entertainment now is it's got to all be right there in front of you. People don't even like really, you know, I think maybe the exception for some people are things like Game of Thrones, you know, but that's like one of the few shows where people are willing to actually wait a whole week to see what the next episode is going to be. Yeah. But by and large, and half of that is, you know, just for titties and violence. But I think
most of it for that, wasn't it?
Yeah, no, it really is. I am an ardent hater of the TV show Game of Thrones, but I do I'll you know, express my nerdiness. I love the book series of Song of Ice and Fire, but that's neither here nor there. But by and large, the way entertainment is being structured now, it's all about constant garbage, you know? And I think it also just lulls people into this, again, this like apathetic, who cares if it's bad TV? I'll watch it.
Much of people's consumption of that is based around the question, have you seen such and such?
Yeah,
have
I know.
Have you seen Breaking Bad? Have you seen Game of Thrones? Have you seen Captain America Civil War? It doesn't really matter what you thought of it. It doesn't really matter how you responded to it. It's just, have you seen it? Yes, right, I've got my little bit of reassurance that everyone's watching the same thing I am. Right, conversation over. Let's talk about the next thing. That have you seen this? Yeah.
No, I know. It's when you're like at a bar,
huge
and
amount of the dialogue is like that, and that's like. I get entertainment is supposed. You know what? This is kind of the whole point, though, isn't it? If entertainment was just mindless escapism, there'd be not much of a problem with it. Okay, yeah. Sometimes it'd be a bit ugly and a bit stupid and a bit kind of beneath us as a species, but lots of things we actually do are ugly and beneath us as a species. So the fact that entertainment reflects that isn't a huge issue to me. The issue to me is that when we're trying to escape from the horrors of the real world, we're being propagandized about the horrors of the real world, that we can't actually escape from them ever into entertaining fantasy land. Because entertaining fantasy land, about three quarters of the time, has the Pentagon or the CIA or the FBI or someone else involved in it. So that's the issue for me. Why can't people just be left alone to enjoy some stupid, you know, titty fest like Game of Thrones? And admittedly, that is one of those shows where I've never discovered any kind of state involvement in it. But as a culture, as a, you know, long-term thing, a huge proportion of our popular culture is somehow involved with the state. And I just think they should either let the culture producers use whatever bits of the state they want without any kind of, we've got to rewrite your script or something in return. They should just say, yes, anyone's allowed to use it as long as they, you know, pay the rental fee or whatever it is. And then culture producers can just get on with making whatever they want to make. Or this shouldn't be available to anyone. That there should just be no involvement of the government in popular culture at all. I think it should be one or the other. Because when you have this deeply politicized involvement, you just end up with these enormous problems. Because then you've got people not making films because they can't get Pentagon support. You've got films being completely rewritten in order to get Pentagon support. You've got the CIA dreaming up projects like Zero Dark Thirty, which are just, I mean, if you analyze them deeply, do come across as some kind of sophisticated psychological warfare operation. This stuff, you know, we shouldn't be bombarded with this stuff when we're just trying to, you know, drink a beer and watch some TV. Why shouldn't people just be allowed to do that? It's not that bad. I mean, it's not that good for you either, but, you know, I still think people should just be allowed to, you know, kind of be left alone in peace to do this.
Well, you know, fast food isn't good for you either, but, you know, you should still be allowed to eat it all, you know, every day if you wanted to.
Well, I guess, yeah.
Yeah. No, I agree. And I also, I think, you know, when people look at this and I've gotten lots of questions, I'm sure you have too, Tom, like, oh, but what's the big deal, you know? And there's obviously the sort of larger aspects. Should the greatest terrorists on the planet, the Pentagon and the CIA, be basically churning out Hollywood films left and right and TV shows? And even I'm sure we're going to see more and more independent films being co-opted by these sort of groups. Is that really good? But on a more sort of base level, on a more just purely entertainment, I think you're really hard pressed to find a movie that was made better by the Pentagon being involved. I know that's our friend Matt Alford, who's written on this extensively. He's got a new book out about Gary DeVore, who knew Chase Brandon briefly. He makes that point, and he always points to Independence Day is still hands down a great action movie, and that got no support from the Pentagon. So, in fact, have even been better without it.
Yeah. Well, as is, like, Crimson Tide. It's actually a really good movie, and the Pentagon turned them down. Pentagon said, we're not, you know, having anything to do with this. In fact, if you look down the, not that IMDb is a great place to go for what's the best movies of all time, because in fact I disagree with like the whole top 50 pretty much. Where's Who Framed Roger Rabbit? That's what I'm always asking. Anyway, but if you look down the list, actually an awful lot of the best ones didn't involve the state. A lot of the most commercially successful ones did. In fact, a majority of them, more than 50%. But the ones that people consider the best, the most kind of beautiful or profound or funny or just kind of all out there spectacle of a film, most of them didn't involve the state. So like you say, they do seem to be having a downward depressing effect on culture, just as a general trend. you asked me before where I think this is going, just seems to be heading even more in that direction. They just latch on to the most mindless dreck and make it even worse quite often.
Yeah.
And just as a telling point to kind of underline all of this, when Michael Bay approached the Pentagon for, I think it was Transformers 3, he did actually say he was looking for them to make it better.
God.
So you have to wonder, how bad was that film when he first took it? Because assuming they did make it at least a little bit better, which maybe they did, it still ended up a pretty bad movie, but nonetheless made, I don't know, $800 million. Made a fortune. I think it might have even topped a billion. I mean, these, like I say, the movies are astonishingly successful commercially, but critically and in terms of the ones that audiences really appreciate and remember and care about and value, very, very few of them. Very few indeed. So you could say Meet the Parents and Meet the Fockers is a pair of very successful, very popular movies that we both think are actually pretty good movies. They're both pretty funny as comedies, which is primarily what they are. And though there is this deep neocon paranoia to Robert De Niro's character throughout, and that is the, we assume, the CIA influence on those films is what really brought that out. Nonetheless, they would be examples against that. They would be, you know, genuinely, I would say, pretty good mainstream movies. Mm. But on the whole, yeah, I think you're right. I think they raid everything.
I think Meet the Parents is like the exception, not the rule. So, but yeah, I mean, that's one movie, you know. I mean, there's a million others that just suck. Also, I mean, you know, we're getting to a point where it's like, it's like all films that are even the you know Academy Award nominated films, they all have Pentagon or CIA involvement. I think it's also just the sort of the increased militarization of society as well. So we should definitely oppose that at all costs. But
it would actually make a very very interesting study. Going through all of the films that were nominated and won Oscars in the last 20, 30 years and tallying up which ones had some kind of state involvement. Because even in the most recent Oscars, which wasn't a particularly state-involved one, what was it, the one Best Picture? Did The Revenant get Best Picture or not? I know DiCaprio won an Oscar for acting in it. He finally got his Best Actor Oscar. But in any case, you know, that won at least one Oscar. I think it won a couple of others as well. And that was produced by none other than Arnon Milchan, the notorious nuclear smuggling Mossad spy, who also was a Hollywood producer. So even there, you have, like, in a film that has absolutely nothing to do with the government, you still have some connection to this world, and quite a substantial one. He produced this film. He, you know, paid for it to be made.
Yes.
So is there some kind of agenda in that film? I don't know. I've not actually seen it, so I'm not going to pass judgment. Mm. But you know, you've got to ask these questions. You've got to wonder, at the top level, both commercially and critically, what is their influence? And it seems to be to render the best movies irrelevant and to promote the dross to the extent that they set the standards that everyone else tries to follow. Because even if you make a war movie without the Pentagon, you can't now make a war movie without having seen, Flags of Our Fathers.
Sure. Saving Private Ryan.
Yeah, all of these sorts of ones. They have set a standard for how you make a war film. And okay, you can subvert that and be a bit creative, but ultimately, you're going to try and make a film that's sort of like those films. And even without the Pentagon, you're still going to end up reflecting some of their values and their mentality and their agenda.
Yeah. No, of course. Again,
I just mean, the knock-on effect.
The hidden influence. You may not even. You sort of wonder, like, where are the George Orwells or Peter, or even like a Stanley Kubrick. I think they would never succeed nowadays in the way that the Hollywood system is set up. They could never get away with some of these movies. I mean, can you you could never imagine like a Citizen Kane now. You know, Rupert Murdoch would sue him. Make sure it never came out. The same with a Stanley Kubrick movie. You'd never see like a Doctor Strangelove. That would be way too subversive. I think that the closest things to something like that would maybe be Wag the Dog. And of course, we have a pretty, well, we think it's pretty solid theory that Chase Brandon was not only involved in that movie, but he is who Robert De Niro is based on. What is it? Conrad Breen is his name. He dresses like Chase Brandon. He looks like Chase Brandon. He operates in some sort of mysterious world in between government and entertainment and public relations. The movie's obviously about faking a war using a Hollywood a film crew. So, you know, you even have to wonder with that, what's really going on there? Why, if Chase Brandon was involved, what was he getting out of that? I don't think it was just his own sense of inflated ego by having kind of slipped himself into that movie.
I think there's something more profound going on there. And I mean, Wag the Dog's a great example because it's a really good movie in a lot of ways. Very, very funny. Very intelligent script. Very well acted. You know, great, some great performances in there and things. And it seems, on the surface, to be quite a subversive movie. It seems to be telling you, hang on, sometimes the government just flat out fakes things and lies to you. But deep down, is not the message of that movie two things? One, if you try and screw over the government, they will probably kill you, as in the case of Dustin Hoffman's character. And two, aren't spin doctors cool?
Yeah.
Because the best character in the whole thing is Robert De Niro's character, Conrad Breen. But he's even worse than a spin doctor. I mean, Barry Levinson says in the commentary that he's not just your common or garden spin doctor. He is something more deep than that, more deeply involved than that. And he is the character who recognizes the CIA. That's the thing that really, like, I thought that was probably the line that they maybe put in to kind of tell you what they're doing with this, that this character is based on a CIA officer, is that when they pull them over in the car, it's Robert De Niro who straight away goes, yep, CIA, that's CIA.
Yeah.
And you think, well, how would he know? He's supposed to just be some PR guy. How does he recognize the CIA on sight? Because those people could be anyone. It'd be NSA, could be FBI, could be, you know, whatever, police, all sorts. But, so are they saying there, yeah, this guy that in every other respect has the same initials, looks the same, does the same job, seems to be Chase Brandon. Are they saying, actually, yeah, he's based on a real CIA guy? And that's ultimately what's going on here, is this is a CIA guy called in by the White House to deal with the, you know, president had some, you know, did some horrible molestation with a teenage girl.
Which is treated like, whatever.
Yeah, well, that even, you know, that topic is treated like it's kind of laughable. Everyone just sort of assumes it's true, but then it's just a triviality. It's just some gossip. So is the message... So is the message of that film, in fact, that government involvement in the entertainment industry is cool? Because that seems to be what they did with Argo, which is like 15 years later. That seemed to very much be the message in that film is, you know, look how cool it is when the CIA gets involved in Hollywood. Look, they, you know, look at John Goodman. So you have to wonder, is that kind of message being teed up in a different sort of a way, in a more subtle way, in a way that makes it seem more subversive, but ultimately isn't in Wag the Dog?
Yeah. Oh, I was going to say, I mean, that was very much how they sold Homeland to the American public, was this is the subversive show. You know, this is looking at, maybe America is going too far with drone strikes and, you know, the vice president
is
evil.
And,
you know, and that's how they kind of hooked, that's how they hooked me in initially. And then, you know, by the end of the first season, you're like, wait a minute. Is this quite the subversive show I thought it was? And then, you know, kick into second gear with the second season, and it basically is just a CIA promotional piece. But by that point, they've already convinced enough people that the CIA is cool and necessary, and that ultimately Carrie is always right, even when she's wrong. You know, she's ultimately right. And Carrie is, of course, Claire Danes, the main character in Homeland. It's also this clever, intricate way that they are getting involved in cinema and in entertainment in general that is, again, very troubling for, you know, just the general direction that culture is going in. You know, not only is culture kind of just going into, you know, gross out, ridiculous crudeness, but also it's crude with the approval of the Pentagon. So, you know, it's like
it's
even worse.
The encouragement of the Pentagon, yeah.
Yeah, yeah,
I mean,
exactly.
Before, you know, people say, what's the big deal here? I'd say, look around you. Look at the general psychological state of Western society, where people are terrified. They either seem to feel nothing, they're apathetic, or they're scared. That's like the general state of our society right now. Why do you think that is? It's not just because of the politics of fear, it's also because of the culture of fear. Mm. And who is promoting the culture of fear more than anyone else? Who is encouraging it more than anyone else? It's the state. It's the CIA. It's the Pentagon. It's all these people we've been talking about. So that, if for no better reason than that, why is everyone so scared? Why is everyone so unhappy? It is partly because of this. It's not entirely because of this. I'm not, you know, trying to blame it all on Chase Brandon and Phil Strub of the Pentagon. It's but they have a role. They've been there, you know, Phil Strub has been the head of the Pentagon's liaison office for nearly 30 years at this point. What kind of influence has he had on popular culture? Quite a substantial one, because he's worked on he's worked on maybe 100 movies in that time. Imagine what you could do making 100 movies and just crafting them in little ways, encouraging them in this direction, taking out a little bit of that and putting in a little bit of this. Imagine the effect of that cumulatively over 30 years. And Phil Strub is not a pleasant man. I know in interviews he comes across as, you know, softly spoken and kind of actually quite affable in his way, but underneath that is a shrewd, cunning, nasty individual. I really, like with Chase Brandon, I have some issues with Phil Strub. I have some sort of hatred there. I won't deny it. But that's why. It's because they're contributing in such a powerful way to everyone being so scared and unhappy or just apathetic. And I don't think that's a good state for people to be in. I don't think, you know, it clearly doesn't make people very happy. It doesn't make them very productive in their lives or feel very fulfilled. And so why not challenge that? Why not try and expose that? Why not try and, in some way, embarrass these people? I mean, that's all I can really do. I can't go in there and shut them down, and I doubt that Congress is going to do either at any point. But what I can do is make it harder for them by, you know, chasing after them with FOIA requests and trying to make sure that this isn't so secretive anymore. And that will embarrass them. That has to have some kind of effect on them.
I think it already has.
I think it already has, yeah. But like I say, I wish we could do more, but we're doing what we can. And it is motivated, for me personally, a lot by this, by the sheer values and psychology of it being so rotten and so detrimental to human goodness.
Well, I mean, you're just talking about how many films Phil Strub is involved in. I mean, he's, with something like that, 100 Hollywood films... That goes more towards indoctrinating or manipulating people than any think tank talking about the, you know, the sort of alternative community in some of the popular things. I think Phil Strub has probably done more than whatever the Trilateral Commission in convincing people of certain ideas, you know? Who really knows, but, you know, just sort of picking that.
It's
as
a bit,
an
a bit
example.
Of a difficult thing to quantify, but the point
yeah,
is
exactly.
He has a very nefarious influence, and yet Phil Strub is not a commonly spoken name among the very people who should be interested in this and should know about this and probably want to know, but maybe don't know quite where to look. But, you know, I'm not trying to criticize people here so much. I'm just saying, find out who these people are and find out what they're up to. Because a lot of people know names like, I don't know, Karl Rove. He was just a White House spin doctor for like 3-4 years. Phil Strub has been there since the late 1980s. He's seen the end of the Cold War, 9/11, the rise of the War on Terror, the rise of ISIS. He's been there throughout all of this. And in
unappointed.
Some ways, yeah, and pretty much unaccountable. And yet, you know, we don't even know who this guy answers to. He supposedly answers to the Undersecretary of Defense for Public Affairs, but there's been like 20 of them since Phil Strub has been there. So clearly they don't have a huge amount of control over it because, you know, none of them last more than about 18 months. So, you know, who does he answer to? What is he actually doing? What is his mission? What is his purpose? Because it's not that clear. And yet he has a very, very powerful role. And of course has the job that everyone wants.
Sure,
this is
sure.
the thing that comes out in a lot of interviews is that, you know, whenever people are asked about that whole world, they're like, yeah, yeah, everyone else in the military is really quite jealous of what we get to do.
Sure,
and you
think,
they probably are. Yeah,
Hollywood parties, you know. Well,
you never have to go and fight anyone. You never have to go and die on some god-awful rock. You don't have to worry about any of that. You've still got your pension and your salary and everything, but you're doing something that's an awful lot more fun.
Yeah. So, you're always in an air-conditioned room. You never have to worry about the heat. Definitely. And I just sort of thinking back on the who are they accountable to, I was just thinking the CIA Inspector General's internal report on this whole thing about their relationship with the entertainment industry. The CIA admits in their own thing that they don't know really who's in control of this. You know, they tell the Inspector General, well, we have no, you know, documented paper or anything on how many films that we have been involved with, the extent to which we are involved in some of these films. So again, I mean, you're just sort of wondering who, if anybody, did Chase Brandon answer to? Or was it just, hey, go out there, do what you want to do? You know, there's probably a few ground rules, but, you know, do it. I mean, who was funding him? Like, where did that money come from to set up an office, to, you know, go to movie sets, to hang out, all that sort of stuff? Which raises questions, you know, that we probably can't get into right now. But, you know, we've briefly touched on the idea of money laundering in Hollywood. And, you know, if you did want to launder some dirty money from a CIA slush fund, Hollywood would be a great place to do it. Most, you know, especially younger directors and things, they're not going to wonder where the money comes from. You know, I'm sure nobody was questioning Arnon Milchan. You know, and when he was investing in films, and this guy,
sure. That guy, you know, that guy's been in Hollywood. He was like there for maybe 20 years, 25 years or something, happily producing movies before anyone started to seriously ask questions about what, hang on.
Yeah. And I had
an FBI document.
Yeah. And I mean, if he's to be believed, I mean, he was like trading nuclear triggers for Israel. I mean, this wasn't like, you know, he was a bag man or something like that. He was fairly high up in the overall chain of command with Mossad and military intelligence. I actually had a listener.
Sure. If that story is to be believed, that he was part of that nuclear smuggling ring, then you're talking about someone who is very trusted. That isn't just some guy that they've sort of got their hooks into a bit in Hollywood. That's someone who is, you know, like, just like I say, very well trusted.
Yeah,
you were going to say
secrets. Oh, no, I was going to say, I had a listener, this was like months ago, and she emailed me, because we were talking about Arnon Milchan in one of our podcasts, and she emailed me, and what is the movie? Kings of New York or some, it's a movie, it's not the right name. Anyway, it's a movie that Robert De Niro was in, and her, I think it was her parents or her, like, her father's father, her grandfather wrote the script, and they all knew, and Arnon Milchan produced that. She said that her parents told her, you know, years later, that there was always something suspicious about Milchan, and just like, you know, where he got all his money. And they said, that, you know, their parents were told the whole time, all he did was run around basically, you know, trucking in women for Robert De Niro the whole time. You know, and it was just a different woman every day. No one ever knew what he did on set. You know, and he always just seemed to have a lot of money. So, you know, just a little, you know, bizarre story. And we at some point we should get into Arnon Milchan some more, because he's crazy. And again, if he's to be believed, he was involved in like the same smuggling group that Netanyahu is alleged to have been involved with. So this guy is goes all over the place. And again, in, you know, nuclear secrets, pretty crazy stuff. But I don't know, Tom, any other or last thoughts on this? Can you stick around for the last half hour? Or?
Oh yeah, I suppose. I'm a bit tired, but yeah, why not?
Okay. Any final thoughts on anything that we've been talking about?
Well, I suppose only just to direct people once again to our series, The CIA in Hollywood, because there are still a couple more episodes to come in this season two, and that will make it 15 episodes, I think, we've done in total by now.
Yeah.
So that's a relatively comprehensive look at the whole relationship between the world's most powerful intelligence agency and the world's biggest culture industry, which is what it comes down to. And I think expressed in those terms, people will understand why that's important. And yeah, it's a fun series that we get into all kinds of different movies. There's a lot of different sorts of analysis. There's a lot of different sorts of information in there. Plenty for people to enjoy and plenty for people to learn from and derive some questions from and all the rest of it. So yeah, just to check out the CIA in Hollywood.
Oh, yeah, of course. And we cover... we cover historical films, we cover comedies, action movies, dramas. We get to talk about aliens for the first time, which was very exciting and different. So yeah, lots in there. But I guess we've only got 20 minutes or something left here. I thought we could maybe quickly just touch on some of the recent events that have been unfolding the past couple of days regarding Turkey. This is just it's too big to dismiss. I recently, earlier today, I recorded something for another podcast I do called Porkins Great Game with my friend Christoph Gehrman, and we get into a lot of the theories and things like that. But Tom, me and you were talking about this a few days ago. We were just sort of trying to wrap our heads around what's going on. And I think slowly a clearer picture is starting to emerge, vis-a-vis the possibility that this is a CIA NATO, plot that, Gulen or Fethullah Gulen, the imam who lives, here in the U.S. and in the Poconos in Pennsylvania, that he or his network was involved at least somewhat. But, Tom, I guess without getting too much into the theories and things like that, I'm just curious how you see this playing out with the alternative media, because there seems to be this weird reaction where suddenly I'm seeing more and more people in the alt media, and we won't name names here, but that are now all of a sudden Erdogan is he's against the New World Order. And he's some sort of a hero, and he's finally stepping up to the CIA. He's going to expose all the secrets about Operation Gladio and terrorism, and Moscow and Ankara are going to form some sort of alliance against NATO and the West. And what's your take on this? Just because it's like, I feel like we have these conversations, me and you, all the time, but this fickle nature with the alt media, where they can just kind of turn on a dime, and suddenly the guy that a week ago was a CIA puppet is somehow overnight turned into Gaddafi. So, what do you think of this?
Well, like you say, turned into Gaddafi, but like we've seen this before. We saw this with Gaddafi. We saw this with Chavez in Venezuela. We saw this to a certain extent with Saddam. We saw this with After Dinner Jihad in Iran. Any time when, you know, some political leader in some geopolitically significant country has some sort of turmoil, it seems that either, you know, if he doesn't get ousted straight away, he's fighting the New World Order. That seems to be what it comes down to, is that if he gets ditched, it's like, oh, well, he couldn't fight the New World Order and they just took over. But if he somehow manages to stay in power... He has to be heroized. People do this with Putin as well.
Yeah.
And while I have some appreciation for the whole notion of a balance of power and that it might actually be a good thing to have a stronger Russia again, maybe, with a lot of caveats and with a lot of reservations attached to that, obviously. you know, but I'm still not like, you know, Putin isn't some hero. He isn't Superman coming to rescue us from our horrible ruling class. That's not happening here. And it's not happening with Erdogan either. He's not, what's he going to expose? I bet he doesn't expose a ruddy thing. It's, and when it doesn't happen, are people going to change their minds again? Are they just going to keep believing this anyway? I mean, how do you test that notion? I suppose is the question. It's like, okay, if you want to believe that, I suppose people can believe it. But if we're being realistic here, our interpretations of geopolitical events have to be testable against what actually happens. So if he is, then what would be the logical thing for him to do? Like you say, team up with Russia. And there have been stories saying that since this coup attempt, this failed coup attempt, there has been some kind of back-channel meeting. But there would be anyway. Why wouldn't there be?
Mm.
I mean, you know, Turkey is right there next to Russia. Of course they're interested. They've got more reason to be interested in Turkey than, you know, the British have, let alone the Americans. I mean, no offense, but you're thousands of miles away.
Yeah. None taken.
Whereas with Russia, it's right on their doorstep. But it's not like any deal has been announced. It's not like anything's really come of this. So until something like that happens, the notion that he's even switched away from NATO and is now somehow allying himself with Russia is pretty weak. Even that sort of basic version of events would be pretty weak until something like that happens, let alone this notion that he's teaming up with Putin to take on NATO or whatever it is, whatever formulation of that people have. So, yeah, just like I say, like we were discussing the other night, we were bouncing around a whole bunch of different theories and saying we don't really know. We can't tell at this point. We don't have enough information to be able to tell. Like I was trying to emphasize, the point is we see what happens next. And we say if this happens, then this theory is more plausible. But if that happens, then that theory is more plausible. We don't wait for the events and then try and find some way to fold it into the narrative we already wanted.
Mm.
Or the narrative that's being popularized by certain commentators or whatever. And certainly there's quite a lot of different reporting on this. I saw Pepe Escobar has an article up today where it's about the Turkish MIT knowing about the coup attempt ahead of time.
Yes.
Only hours ahead of time. But nonetheless, knowing about it ahead of time and allowing it to go ahead.
Mm.
So what does that imply? I'm just saying, you've got people advocating that narrative, and I'm not sure that it's true, but again, Pepe Escobar is not in the habit of just selling nonsense. He's not in the habit of just sort of making things up, so you have to consider that at least some sources are saying this. So we have a very complicated situation that's very difficult from the outside to know how to interpret, but like I say, I think the important thing is always what actually happens, rather than... how do we create an icon out of this? But many people, they want to see the theater. They want to see the theater. They want to see the heroes. They want to see the Game of Thrones, Pierce, you know?
Yeah, no, I know. Exactly. Yeah. And just sort of then it's as the events actually unfold, as we do start to piece things together, then we see, you know, everyone is sort of recrafting their whatever predictions or analysis to fit this. So now it's not, this isn't a botched coup, which, I mean, if this was truly, now I know that I am buying a little bit more into the notion that Erdogan and his close circle of friends found out about this. And obviously the writing was on the walls, you know, there were countless people in the mainstream and in the alternative that were predicting that there would be some sort of military coup or some sort of serious confrontation. Because, I mean, you know, since 2013, Erdogan has been cracking down on Gulenists everywhere. Obviously, he's gone balls to the wall in the past 48 hours, but this is nothing new. But if this was found out, and if we're, you know, some Turkish sources saying that, you know, on the 16th and 17th, you know, just a few days ago, maybe even into the 19th, mass arrests were supposed to take place. Even with all of that, this is the most botched operation that the CIA has been involved with since the Bay of Pigs. I mean, they completely misinterpreted public support for Erdogan, which is, I mean, it doesn't take a CIA analyst to see that he's wildly popular within Turkey. There seems to have been no plan B. I understand that, and then that story changes. You know, you get the pro Erdogan people, oh, this is, you know, idiots. We caught them off guard. Then, Erdogan was about to be shot out of the sky. And it sort of grows back and forth. And now we see people saying, oh, well, this was really just a dry run for the CIA coup. What dry run? They're never going to get another shot at it. By my count now, he's arrested almost 10,000 people, including military officials, generals, governors. He's just put 3 million civil servants. He's like stopped payment to them. How could the CIA ever get anything going now? You know, and this idea that
unless there's some kind of huge public backlash against him, which we don't see any real signs of. We see most people saying, well, we kind of expected this. We kind of expected there would be a kickoff. There would be some sort of trouble. There would be some sort of either putsch attempt or at least, you know, just some general chaos and troublemaking against Erdogan. And they expected, and the response from that is the government won't fall. They will just turn around and crack down even worse on these people. And that's exactly what we've happened. And it seems the Turkish public, not, you know, down to a person, obviously, but quite a lot of them accept this and are not going to turn around and protest on behalf of the Gulenists. And that actually this coup is completely dead in the water. So unless, you know, the tide somehow turns the other way, you're right. The CIA, assuming this is, you know, going down by, you know, that paradigm, that theory, they're not going to get another chance. You don't do a dry run for a coup.
No, what's the point? Yeah, exactly. It's also like, so you're going to have your entire core parallel state arrested and, murdered in some cases overnight for a dry run. I mean, they'll never get another shot at it. And then, you know,
at best allowed to, like, flee the country in shame or something.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Those people aren't going to be active in 6 months' time causing another coup. I really can't see that.
No, Erdogan is talking about reinstating the death penalty, and I don't really see any pushback from that, even amongst the liberals in Turkey. So, I mean, yeah, what dry run? No, and again, too, you know, and I know that he's been using Incirlik, this airbase in southern Turkey, which is a joint NATO-Turkish airbase. He's been using that as leverage. But, listen, the U.S. is still flying missions out of there right now against ISIS. There's also, one of the largest nuclear arsenal outside of the U.S. that's run by NATO is in Incirlik. They're not going to risk anything over that. I've seen these reports and being put out there in the alt media and even in somewhat in the mainstream media as well. Oh, there could be some. NATO is going to come in and they're going to overthrow and blah, blah, blah. And I've seen these pronouncements by Stoltenberg, who's the Secretary General of NATO, that NATO is going to look into the crackdown and blah, blah, blah. Why would NATO is going to risk a civil war with their most important ally? Because what? He's pissed off at Gulen? I mean, it just seems so far from reality. The coup is over. It failed.
Whoever and whatever was
there. Yeah, exactly. Right.
And whether they intended it this way or not.
Yeah.
This is, like I say, these are the facts on the ground. So
I'm
with you. I don't see why they would take that sort of risk in a country that they've essentially turned into a nuclear armed country. Turkey can't order those missiles fired, but you know what I mean. They're kind of on their territory.
To a certain extent,
they do have some power over them.
Sure. But at the same time, Erdogan, close personal friends with al-Qaeda's main financier, Yasin al-Qadi. Okay, this guy is, I mean, the definition of a deep state agent. Funded PTEC, the software used to, 9/11 wouldn't happen without this guy. Good friends with him. You think he's going to, like, even if he revealed secrets, who cares? This guy, Erdogan, is a scumbag, all the same. He's hanging out with al-Qaeda guys. His son is working with ISIS to ship out oil illegally from Syria. This guy is dirty, and he knows, too. You know, if he, if he, again, I keep seeing, again, these memes that Erdogan is going to stand up and blah, blah, blah. He's not an idiot. Everyone that has ever stood up to NATO or the CIA has been killed and actually killed. You know, they actually have a real revolution or you know, quote, revolution or coup or whatever it may be, and they get rid of him. You know, and you're talking about countries where it's easy to do that. Libya, for instance, Cote d'Ivoire in West Africa. Iraq even. Turkey? That's never going to happen. I mean, there's just too much at stake. Why would he jeopardize – right now he has some cards to play. Why would he jeopardize that with some sort of confrontation with NATO? It just makes no sense. And why would NATO ever let it get to that position?
Well, this is what I don't understand is if things were going sour with Erdogan, which they have a bit – you know, we can't deny there have been some rumblings of disagreement and whatever. But if that was true, do they not have other ways of applying pressure aside from trying to take over the government? I mean, that's like a last resort, usually. Or it would be in a country like Turkey. Mm. Maybe it's earlier than the last resort if it's a place like Ghana.
Mali.
Yeah. There they might think, well, no one's really going to care if there's a change of government anyway, so if we can encourage one and help one happen, we might as well. But in Turkey, no, you would find another way to apply pressure. You'd find another way to get the guy back on side and back doing at least most of what you want him to do. So, yeah, this seems like if it is that way around, it's an extreme step that they have bungled completely, and they have just handed him half of the deck of cards and said, you're now in a position of greater power than we are. So even from the point of view of the CIA, like a risk-reward calculation, why would they do it?
Yeah.
That's what
I know. I'm still not even entirely convinced that this was that it was meant to actually succeed.
I have seen that one, too, is a few more people suggesting maybe this was always intended to fail, that it was just some kind of warning shot across the bows. I can buy that a lot more easily.
Because
if not, then like you say, just the whole thing was so messed up.
Like, no, I mean, the CIA they forgot how to do a coup.
Maybe they have.
I mean, I there is some credence to the idea that this was discovered ahead of time and that they were gonna go forward with these mass arrests, and that, you know, the coup was supposed to take place, I believe it was like that night, but late, like 3 a.m, which makes more sense because people are asleep, you know, if you take over and then suddenly people wake up and maybe you have one of the major political parties in Turkey, the CHP, for instance, which is the Liberal Secularist Party, which has been closer to Gulen in recent years, they, you know, whatever, form allegiances with the military. Maybe then people are, okay, I guess this is it now. You know, we went to bed with Erdogan, now it's this guy. These guys are in power. That maybe could work, but I'm still left thinking that no matter what happens, they were going to blame Gulen. Does the CIA want everybody and their mother Googling who Gulen is? You know, my parents now know who this guy is. Yeah. They don't want people like my parents to know who Gulen is. So again, I'm not sure if it really, you know, makes total sense. And it's just interesting to see the way that this is being interpreted across the media spectrum. Then, of course, you get, Iran initially blamed Saudi Arabia and I believe and Qatar, you know. And anyway, Tom, thank you for joining us for this first episode. Everybody can find your work, of course, at spyculture.com. Everyone can find my work at porkinspolicyreview.com. And I hope you enjoyed this. I hope you will join me next Tuesday. Next Tuesday, of course, I'll be speaking with Brian Heiss, who is a researcher who looks into the O.J. Simpson trial, and we're going to be talking about his brand new film. But Tom, thank you so much for joining me on the very first broadcast here on AFR.
Thank you, Bit.
News and information you can trust. This is American Freedom Radio. Freedom, freedom, American Freedom Radio. Radio.